As you know from the agenda, the award recipient this year is Oregon State Treasurer Ted Wheeler. And Treasurer Wheeler protects the state's financial health and also seeks to improve the financial security of Oregon families and businesses. Under his leadership, the Oregon Treasury manages the investment of an $82 billion portfolio that includes Oregon Public Employees Retirement Fund, that includes the Oregon Employees Retirement Fund. The Oregon Treasurer's returns were recognized in 2013 as the highest among large public plans for the past decade. Because Treasurer Wheeler knows that the state's economic future is closely tied to education, he authored and is working to pass the Oregon Opportunity Initiative, a plan to reverse the state's divestment in higher education and put vocation training and college within the reach of more low and middle income Oregon families. The reason we're honoring Treasurer Wheeler today is I had the pleasure and privilege of meeting him about a year ago when he convened a meeting for public sector pension plan, a trade association, and employee groups with some folks in the private equity and hedge fund industry who obviously rely on institutional investors to begin a conversation about retirement security for not just public employees, but about employees in the private sector. The folks that Preston and Kara and Michael, particularly Michael's boss, Tom Harkin, are focused on, the 50% of Americans who work for employers who do not have access to retirement, employer-sponsored retirement savings vehicle. And so over the months, Treasurer Wheeler has been very active in this area, trying to have a conversation and develop conversations along a state-based solutions to retirement insecurity for the private sector. Treasurer Wheeler was born in Portland and has deep roots in Oregon. The Wheeler family has been in Oregon for six generations, and the town of Wheeler on the coast is named after his great-grandfather, who founded a sawmill there in 1912. He earned an economics degree from Stanford University, a master's degree from Columbia University, and Kennedy School of Government at Harvard. So obviously he doesn't know how to challenge himself. He was employed in the financial sector before entering elected office. Driven by a passion for outdoors, Treasurer Wheeler was a longtime volunteer for Portland Mountain Rescue and the founder of Walk for the Woodland Trails. His accomplishments beyond his job as treasurer include snowshoeing to the North Pole and summiting Mount Everest, and he still climbs Mount Hood to this day. Please join me in thanking Treasurer Wheeler for all his activities in promoting retirement security.
Well, thank you very much, Hank, for that kind introduction. And thanks to all of you. I think this is a tremendous honor. I take it with the humility it deserves. I understand that this year you looked at a number of United States senators and congressmen, but they were mathematically eliminated from contention. And then you looked for potential partners. I want you to know that I come here and I speak on behalf of a lot of other people who frankly deserve to stand here in my stead, people who have deeper experience, people who are greater leaders, people who have even more passion and vision. And I hope that I can carry their burden on my shoulders as well. But I want to tell you that I appreciate this tremendously because it shows something of a new day. It was only recently that treasurers were really thrust into the spotlight. I was actually appointed state treasurer before I was elected. I had 24 hours to decide whether or not I wanted to take the job. And I, of course, consulted a number of my friends to ask their opinion, and they were mixed. They were mixed. Of those who said I should not take the position, they came in two camps. Camp number one is, you'll be bored. For a guy like you, this is probably not the right step. The other camp of naysayers were people who said, you're going to get on the cutting edge of a great deal of problems that are coming down the pike. Who would have guessed 8 years ago that you, as members of NCPERS, and we, as elected state treasurers, would find ourselves struggling with massive losses in our defined benefit plans? Prior to 2008, our defined benefit plan was 107% funded. A year later, it had lost 35% of its value. Not only did we have to struggle with that as elected treasurers, we then had to weather, right alongside you, the brewing storm around pension reform. And then after that, there was the hangover from the collapse of Wall Street in the form of securities litigation. And again, treasurers found themselves on the front page of the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal. And then subsequent to that, the spotlight turned to us. As elected officials who are easily accessible, people know where I shop, they know where my kids go to school, they know where I live. They couldn't get to Wall Street, but they could get to us. And so everything we did, the way we organized our investment operations, how much we paid our employees, even how we traveled to conferences like this one, what we ate for dinner while we were here, and who we ate dinner with, all of those were the subject of significant scrutiny and public discussion. So the job of the treasurer, in short, is one that I have never found boring. I have never found boring, and I feel like somebody mentioned this was an island. I feel very welcome on your island, and I appreciate this great honor that you've bestowed on me. I was asked to speak for a few minutes on what I believe is the greatest economic threat to our country, certainly the greatest threat to my state of Oregon. The president's going to talk about it in his State of the Union address, rightfully so. And that's the issue of rapidly growing income disparity in the United States. But retirement security is the piece of that we're here to discuss today. And it's a very important part of that overall picture. We have to take a little bit of a trip. Join me for a moment in the Wayback Machine. Do you all remember the Wayback Machine? Some of you do. So we're in the Wayback Machine, and we're going back to the beginning of this Great Recession. In my opinion, the Great Recession was caused by three main factors. First of all, was too much leverage on Wall Street. The second was a lack of financial controls and accountability that could have prevented the precipitous decline and the speed with which that decline happened. And the third factor was a factor that's been with us since the beginning of humanity, greed. Leverage, lack of accountability, and greed are a very volatile combination. Whatever you think the causes were, the consequences have been obvious and well documented. Americans watched on helplessly, particularly working class Americans, as millions of jobs evaporated in record time. They watched as they and people they knew, their neighbors, lost their homes. They watched as retirement security that had been hard won evaporated. Nobody was safe. Nobody was safe, not the young. The young watched as the cost of their higher education escalated rapidly, 25% in my state over a 4-year period. Then they graduated into a job market where the jobs that would historically be taken by young people had largely disappeared. Not the old. I knew so many people who were just on the threshold of retirement, just as the value of their pension plans deteriorated precipitously. That not only created an economic problem for them, it also created a life planning problem for them, as they had to rethink what retirement actually meant and whether or not they would have such a retirement. So it comes as small consolation to many working Americans that economic people and financial people pronounce that we're in the recovery. We've recovered. Well, it's been an uneven recovery. Wall Street has certainly recovered the last week, notwithstanding. But there's no question. We've seen corporate profitability increase dramatically, and along with that, the wages and the wealth of people who are closely tied to securities increased precipitously. The top 1% has seen their income grow by nearly 33% between 2009 and 2012. This isn't one of those speeches where I lob bombs at people who are wealthy or people who are successful or denounce profitability. That's not my point at all. My point is a deeper and larger point. The point is, as the economy is recovered, and I go out and I talk to people across the state of Oregon. The state of Oregon is mixed, for all the way from very urban, liberal, progressive to very rural conservatives. But they all tell me the same thing. They tell me, I don't feel like the recovery has happened. And when you talk to them a little more, what they say is, we've left something behind. We lost a piece of ourselves during this Great Recession, something that was very valuable to us. And we're only now starting to define what it is we lost. And what we lost was the economic security of the middle class in the United States. The economic vibrancy of this nation has always been defined by the economic circumstances of the middle class. I don't want to make it a rich versus poor conversation. Ultimately, that has a lot of overtones. It leads to some very unproductive dead ends. But you have to acknowledge the facts. And the facts are that this isn't just about the wealthy getting wealthier and the poor getting poor. It's about the wealthy getting wealthy at a much faster pace and demonstrably doing it at the expense of the middle class, who've seen their wages stagnated since 1999. So into this context comes the gasoline on top of the fire. The gasoline is retirement insecurity for the 40% of Americans who do not currently have retirement strategies other than Social Security. I want to be even more provocative, because it's in the afternoon and you deserve that from somebody you've just given an important award to. Even though I see this as an economic crisis, I think it's more important than that. I actually think this goes well beyond being an economic crisis. I think it's a social crisis. This is a crossroads for our nation. That social crisis resulting from the economic crisis threatens to erode the very foundations of our democracy. There's an old adage. You heard it from your grandparents. You heard it from your parents. It was beat into our heads that if you work hard and you play by the rules, you can get ahead in this country. It's not a guarantee, except a guarantee of opportunity that has heretofore existed. And now that guarantee seems to be in question. That contract from one generation to the next feels like it's broken. And retirement security gets us right to the fore of that conversation. Everybody should be entitled in their old age to economic security at some level. I think we can all agree on that. Everyone in their old age should be able to live their last years with a sense of self-sufficiency and dignity. That's at the basic level of where we are. We've heard today a lot of conversations about retirement security. I think there's two steps we need to take. They're clear steps. The first step, of course, is we have to acknowledge that the problem exists. The second step is we have to stop talking about the problem and get to the action plan. What are we going to do about it? I think we largely acknowledge the problem. We've heard the 40% statistic. We've heard the 53% retirement security statistic. We in this room understand that the problem is going to get larger with time, not smaller. In my own state, the number of older adults above the age of 65 is expected to double in the next 20 years. So acknowledging the problem is more than just looking at the raw statistics. There's two aspects to acknowledging this important issue that we haven't come to grips with yet, that we have not reached anything close to a consensus on. The first is to acknowledge that the private sector cannot on its own solve the retirement security crisis without a meaningful, productive partnership with the public sector. If I were a pessimist, I would look at the statistics and I would say, wow, there's 40% of people in the United States who don't have something, retirement security, that they desperately want. That's called a market failure. The optimist would look at that 40%, as I do, and say, wow, 40% of people in the United States don't have something they really want. That's an opportunity. And that's why there's an opportunity for a meaningful and productive dialogue between the private sector and the public sector. That's the first piece of what we need to acknowledge. The second piece that we need to acknowledge, and this is probably the tougher one, is that this is not an individual problem. This is not an individual problem. This is a societal problem. We can rant, we can gnash teeth, we can fret that people don't have retirement security, but regardless of why they do or do not have retirement security, the bottom line is this: if they get into their old age and they don't have access to the resources they need to be able to survive, we as Americans aren't the kind of people who are just going to kick them to the curb. That's not us. It's never been us and it never will be us, which means that there is a societal cost to not addressing this important issue today. Today, while it's still a manageable cost. So we also have to acknowledge the reality that Social Security is not going to continue to be a viable single source of retirement security for Americans, not with the dynamics in the population, not with a Congress that seems hell-bent on actually reducing Social Security benefits for Americans. Social Security wasn't created as a long-term, full standard of living retirement option. You all know that. It was created at a time when people retired at 62, and actuarially, they died at 67. It was meant to be a short-term support for people in their retirement, to help them live with dignity and with economic self-sufficiency. But we've outsmarted ourselves. We live a lot longer than that through improved nutrition, improved health care, improved lifestyle habits. If you and three of your peers live to the age of 65, the odds are that one of you will live into your 90s. That's today, and that may actually increase with time. That means some people will be living on retirement benefits from Social Security for decades. It just wasn't intended to do that. So that's the first piece. Acknowledge the problem. Understand we have joint ownership, that there have to be unique partnerships that are built. The second piece is the action plan, doing something about it. And you heard a number of ideas that were proffered here on this stage in front of this important audience in terms of what needs to be done. I'm very proud to be part of a national coalition of leaders that include labor, like my friend John Adler, who's going to speak right after me. Proud to be part of a coalition that includes investment organizations. Proud to be part of a coalition that includes Democrats and Republicans as diverse as Ken Melman from KKR and Kathleen Kennedy Townsend. proud to be part of a coalition that includes retirement security advocates like the AARP, and now proud to be part of a coalition that includes state treasurers. I had the opportunity, as Hank said, to convene a group of state treasurers recently on this subject. I was proud to see a lot of treasurers, and I was proud to see them from all parts of the political spectrum step up and say, yeah, this is a huge issue, and we need to be at the forefront and do something about it. And what we agreed to do was create a center for retirement security initiatives and to fund that center for retirement security initiatives. Tentatively, Georgetown University has agreed to host that center. They're not going to come up with the answer. We in the states will serve as incubators of ideas. No two states may approach this subject of retirement security the same way. California may have one plan, Oregon another, and Louisiana a third. But we in the states need to provide leadership, understanding we have different politics, we have different economies, we have different political pressures and powers, we have different corporate sponsorship. But we need to talk about what we can do in our state to move the ball forward. And I'm very proud of this national coalition and the work we've done to help serve as a center of ideas and best practices and help people like me, state treasurers, understand the language we need to use to help move the dialogue forward in a productive and positive way. We've also agreed on two key principles that we want to look at pooling resources to help keep the cost low for retirement security, and we think professional management is a good thing. I'm particularly enthusiastic about professional management. You see, before I was state treasurer, I was the county executive for the greater Portland, Oregon area. It's called Multnomah County. It's a hard one to spell. It's even harder to pronounce. And the reason I wanted to be the executive of Multnomah County wasn't so I could come here and give speeches about retirement or give speeches about finance or manage my state's budgetary issues or financial issues. No, the reason I ran for county executive was to help vulnerable populations. I'd served for 8 years as a volunteer shelter host, and I slept on the floor along with homeless families in Portland. And that motivated me to want to help others who are vulnerable, people who are in poverty, people who lived with disabilities, people who are older, people who lived with mental health issues, which unfortunately are abundant in my community. But before I was treasurer, that was my commitment. And it's shaped everything I do as treasurer, and that's why this retirement security issue is profoundly important to me. People without retirement security are vulnerable, and they deserve to have us meet them halfway to help them in their old age. But there's another reason that I'm motivated to be part of this coalition. You see, before I was treasurer, and before I was county executive working with vulnerable populations, I was a senior management executive at a company that sold retirement plans. We had Taft-Hartley plans, but most of our business was selling defined contribution plans to the public. I live with those people. Portland's a small town by comparison to where we are now. And I've seen what has worked and what hasn't worked. And I feel like I have a personal stake in making sure that we shape this discussion in a way that helps people who have found that their retirement didn't work out the way they wanted through, frankly, no fault of their own. The Oregon experience has been a positive one as well. We passed legislation in our last session, House Bill 3436, it creates a work group that I chair to look at what the current status of retirement security is in our state, to look at tools that are available to us, to look at tax incentives that might help shape retirement security, to look at accountability and oversight mechanisms that could help us be responsible in how we construct a plan. The private sector was very involved in the creation of this task force. They sit on the task force along with unions and retirement advocates and concerned citizens and community leaders. We agreed to further principles, that the resources should be pooled to save costs, that they should be transportable plans. If you go from one employer to another, obviously it has to come with you. It has to be simple. And the legislature added to the bill at the last minute that it has to be completely voluntary for the employees, that it can incur no liability on the private sector, and it can incur no liability on the state of Oregon. So you see, our sideboards are very different, perhaps, than what other states will put in. We'll rely heavily on this center at Georgetown for ideas that can help shape our discussion. But in conclusion, I know this. Your voice and your experience at the table is critical. You represent a huge number of Americans and are responsible for their retirement security. It's a huge burden. You already know that. You're also grizzled veterans of the reform movement. You've already fought a lot of battles, and you have some understanding and insight into what is yet to come. I can't succeed without you in my efforts to help improve retirement security, but I know that with friends like you, I can't fail. We can't fail. I want to thank you again for having me here. I want to thank you again for including a state treasurer amongst many in your discussions. And I want to thank you most of all for the work that I know you are going to do in the years ahead on this important issue. Thank you all for having me here today.
Now you know why we're honoring Ted today, and I am here presenting him an award that says, "The Voice for Public Pensions, Ted Wheeler, Oregon State Treasurer, 2013 Elected Official of the Year, National Conference on Public Employee Retirement Systems."
Thank you, Mel. Appreciate it.